Are you guys receiving?
Yes,
Yeah.
it's okay. Yeah, we got
Okay,
it.
so the title for this presentation is A Small Patient with Big Injuries. And I would like once more to thank for the opportunity to be here representing SMITE. So I think it's important that I give you some info so you can understand how I used it to work in the place where this patient was operated. For 12 years, I worked at a trauma hospital located at Pará State. It's a state in the Amazon region in Brazil. And only this state is twice the size of France. And in all this territory, we had only one vascular surgeon on duty 24/7. And at this day, I was that guy. And we worked at a hospital that was dedicated for trauma care. So, because this was the only hospital with vascular surgeons specialized in trauma, we had a high income of many types of trauma. And for almost a decade, I am publishing about the challenges that is to operate these patients because my region is unique in geographic features. And this high income of cases made us have some experiences in many kinds of vascular injuries, including in children. And the case that we are going to see today was one of the most challenging ones I have ever operated. And that's boy's case. So the case, it was a patient of 9 years old, and he accidentally found his father's shotgun that his father used for hunting. And he sustained a self-inflicted accidental shotgun wound, entering in the epigastric and exiting in the lumbar region. He was brought by ambulance, and he took about 6 hours traveling for being taken care of. And obviously, he arrived in shock. After primary measures in the ER, the patient was taken immediately to the operating room. And I think the first thing to decide, since it was a kid, a young boy, was about the access. So I will ask my friend Gustavo Parreira here to help me with the panelists. I think it's worth to discuss if anyone would like to perform a transverse laparotomy in this kid.
Well,
Any
it's
comments?
open for discussion. I'm not sure if you guys are having the same problem I have because I can't open my camera.
Yeah, Dr. Pereira, this is Kevin with the University of Miami. I told the group we actually restricted it so only the host can share their video because we've had some issues the 2 weeks ago when someone came on and was sharing some inappropriate things in their background video. So as a
Okay, so the problem is the
precaution,
camera.
yeah,
Okay.
unless there's a way that the host can turn on video just for the panelists. I don't know if there's a way to do that or not, but if not, we'll just have to just use the audio and not the video.
So if you are just not able to look other ones' face, I'd like to invite everyone to raise your hand in the software. You know, there is a little hand there you can touch, and you had oh your raise your hand so we can discuss. I can find one to speak here. I will start with people. Yeah, Stephen Utrecht, Dr. Utrecht, I would start with you too. Thank you for being here helping me.
You're welcome. So, first of all, the exit wound lumbar region, right or left, and what level of the how high or low on the back?
To the right and in the upper level, almost in the transition to the torso.
Okay, so the patient's right side. So on the liver side. Okay, right. Would I consider transverse? Pediatric surgeons for certain known conditions favor, or at least in my day, they favored the transverse incision when you, Dr. Adenauer, would have been a pediatric patient, if God forbid. But that in those days, that's what they were doing. But in this case, I wouldn't. And in general, for trauma, certainly with adults, a doctor can be open to criticism, or at least back in the day, they would be open to criticism making a transverse incision, even if everything goes well. In this case, it depends on what you would need to access. You don't know if you wouldn't need access lower in the abdomen. And just looking at the pictures that you showed, there's less displacement required from a midline incision to access the entire abdomen than there would be to access the entire abdomen with a transverse incision at the level of the mid-epigastrium. So I would still do a midline incision in this case, especially for a patient in shock. Although I think 9 hours after the injury, if he comes in, it depends on how severe the shock is. Is he making urine? What's his lactate level? And the other factors, but I think if not being shot 9 hours after an injury with omentum sticking out, I think the severity of the injury is such that he was able to survive that long. So I'd still be optimistic with this patient.
Any other thoughts?
Can go ahead.
Okay, I completely agree with Dr. Utrecht. And the reason I put that up for discussion is that, as he said, many pediatric surgeons would go for a transverse incision. And I must admit that sometimes I have made transverse incisions when operating trauma in kids. But for this specific case, I looked to the abdomen, and even though he was 9 years old, he was, I think, suitable for a midline incision. And there's no way a transverse incision is going to be faster to be performed than a midline incision. So I took my chances with the midline incisions, straight up laparotomy from a laparotomy. And when I got into the cavity, I saw a massive hemiperitoneum, retroperitoneal hematoma dissecting zones 1, a high zone 1 supramesocolic hematoma, and zone 2 on the right side. The hematoma was dark, it was big, but it was not pulsatile. And there was obvious GI injury because of some alimentary content. And at that point, the blood pressure dropped even more to about 8/4. So at that point, what would be our next maneuver?
Okay, thank you. Again, I ask you to raise your hand, please. I'd like to speak. Dr. Horacio Horschman. Horacio, thanks.
No, thank you. I have a few questions. You say that this was self-inflicted, but it's kind of very difficult even for an adult to self-inflict an injury with a shotgun because you have a long barrel. So how the kid could shot that appears to be, based on your description, went through and through at that level. So how he put the shotgun flat to be able to shoot himself? I would be very concerned that somebody did this to him. But anyway, so that would be the main thing. The other thing is that, yeah, I totally agree with you on the vertical incision. The transverse incision, particularly in pediatric, has a better cosmetic advantage and allegedly less chance of a hernia. But in a case like this, that you need exposure to the whole aorta, is probably not a good approach. I don't know if this, did you have any x-rays before you open to get an idea of the trajectory? No x-rays. And was he moving the legs? Was he moving?
Yes, he was moving.
He was moving. So the spine is intact. So that, based on the location and the description of the hematoma, the concern is that this is an IVC injury. And the problem is that to get more proximal control, you might be having to deal with the presence of the liver. So that's a problem. But the way to approach this would be to do a Cattell maneuver. First of all, I will make sure that I have blood products in the OR. I keep pressure, talk to anesthesia, make sure that they have blood products in the OR. And when they have everything ready, that's the time I will address the hematoma. And it will be doing a Cattell maneuver and a Cocker maneuver to get ex complete exposure of the IVC and deal with whatever is there. The advantage of the IVC in terms of proximal and distal control, because it's very soft, the walls are very soft.
Hello, hello.
Yes, hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I'm hearing you.
Okay. Yeah, so you can get by compression, and I many times, particularly in a kid this age, it's easier to get compression between two fingers, kind of using the index and the middle finger, compressing in both sides of the perforation until things can get under control. Sometimes you have a lumbar vein draining there, and that can prevent from getting control. But the advantage is that in terms of get proximal and distal control, it's easy to do it by just simple pressure while the IVC is dissected better, and using clamps after that. Thank you.
I think this strategy.
Let me ask a question for you guys from United States. You have Reboa as a possibility to use in these situations. Would you use something like that for this case? Here in Brazil, you don't have this opportunity.
Reboa is not what you want.
Yeah, I totally agree with Dr. Frisby. We did a group of sessions. We did a review of the literature published on Reboa, and submitted as a guidelines to EAST. And we found surprisingly that the evidence of the literature is extremely poor for the use of Reboa in trauma. Surprisingly, despite everything that's being said, the quality of the literature is very poor, to the point that we couldn't make recommendations for the use of Reboa. Unfortunately, when we submitted, at least one of the reviewers was one of the guys obviously publishing on Reboa, and he criticized us for not using Reboa, that how we dare to write this without us personally using Reboa, which it was a very poor argument because we are analyzing the literature. Maybe it works, but the quality of the literature is extremely poor for the use of Reboa in cases like this. So
I've got a question for you. Nobody's concerned about the fact that, you know, when you have a shotgun blast, first thing I'd want to know if I had the economy of time is that a slug or is it a double aught or what size are the pellets? The second thing is, I don't think anybody should be excited about the fact that you dropped the blood pressure because you lost the tamponade. The moment you open, tamponade's gone. So I would have all the blood products I could find in the operating room at that time. Those are the only two observations I can make. Could you tell what kind of shot it was?
What kind of shot?
Yeah, the size of the pellets.
No, I don't know. You know, that's a very interesting thing, and it has something to do with what Dr. Horacio has just told us about the long barrel. And here in the Amazon, we have a lot of self-made guns that use improvised ammunition. They sometimes use many things like nails and all kinds of stuff.
Right.
And they prepared that, and they saw the barrel to make it shorter. And they use these kind of weapons to make, how do you say, traps in the middle of the wood. So they can catch animals when they step into the trap. So my thoughts is that this boy found something like that at home. But at that point, I didn't make many questions about that. I was straight for laparotomy, so I don't know the details about that.
Right. In the United States, in some of the urban areas, people have been known to make what are commonly known in America as zip guns. It's about the same thing. It's used, well, it's not used on four-legged animals, but it's used on two-legged ones.
And, I completely understand that.
Yeah. So most probably this sounds like a self-manufactured weapon. And that may be the reason why he got a self-inflicted wound. But it's anybody's guess. That's all I have. Thanks.
Yes, I completely agree. But and I liked very much what Dr. Horatio has described about the technique for exposures and how to control the IBC bleeding. If possible, I do not recommend to put clamps. I recommend to start with the fingers because the walls in the vein are much more delicate. But even though sometimes you need to put clamps.
Could you not also use just a sponge on a stick? Just a little pressure above and below the wound itself. Yeah.
Each case is unique, as trauma surgeons know.
Yeah.
But anyway, for this case,
would you let me just ask you, Adenauer? Would you open this hematoma without a proximal aortic clamp, even in thorax or in the hiatus?
Yeah, that's the thing, Pajera. For example, I thought that if I open this hematoma, I could instantly lose the patient. So I decided to go to a aortic cross clamp.
Okay.
I just thought, like you did, that maybe the blood pressure dropped even more. And we didn't have all the blood products we should have. And I decided to perform a cross clamp for that. And when you take a look for our options, well, the surgeon must decide between cross-clamping the descending aorta through a thoracotomy or the supraceliac aortic clamp. And I went for the supraceliac aortic clamp. This is the option for the thoracotomy and the descending in another case, just for illustrative purposes. And some tips if we are going to perform a supraceliac aortic cross clamp. The first one is to use a large nasogastric tube so you can feel with your hands the esophagus and use that to orientate you to the diaphragm pillar. And the other is not to perform what I have performed in this case, meaning I have surrounded with the umbilical tape the aorta. I think this is not a difficult maneuver to perform, in my opinion. And in the beginning, I didn't feel confident to put the clamp in the aorta without surrounding it. But the fact is that in this region, it's very dangerous to do that. As you can see in the picture, the vena cava is much closer to the aorta. And when you put the mixture, the right angle clamp through the back wall of the aorta, you can get inside the vena cava and enhance your problems. So the best way to do it is just to be confident and do like in this other case and feel the spine behind the aorta and just put the clamp there feeling against the spine and close the aorta. And then we need to decide how to explore this hematoma. Dr. Horatio already has just suggested the Cattell maneuver. You can choose also the Mattox maneuver. And many trauma surgeons, they don't use an approach that as a vascular surgeon, I have been taught for operating ruptured aortic infrarenal aortic aneurysms, but sometimes if you open straight between the inferior mesenteric vein and the duodenum, you can access the inframesocolic section of the zone one. And for infrarenal injuries of the aorta and the vena cava, it can be a good option. So we have these three options. Any thoughts about how to proceed? Everybody, so please, Dr. Horatio.
Would like, please raise your hand. Dr. Miller, Kevin Miller. I'm just looking here, people who are used to coming here.
Dr. Antrak's hand is up.
Okay, let's go ahead.
In this case, not only control of the aorta, but because you have the blue blood and you said that the bullet is exits on the right side at the junction between the chest and the diaphragm, it's likely to be an injury of the retrohepatic IVC high up. And so I think you need to have adequate control. And to do that, you need to be above the liver and below the liver on the IVC. So initially, getting into the abdomen when the blood pressure fell, I would have just with fingers compressed the aorta against the spine at the hiatus, and then compress the inferior vena cava below the liver against the retroperitoneum, just with hand or peanuts or sponge stick, whatever. And then for the proximal control, if you can't expose the suprahepatic IVC by mobilizing the liver, and it should be relatively easy, or if the injury is so high that, you know, it's at the diaphragm, then in this case, and here the midline incision, I think, works your advantage. I would just extend that up through the sternum and get control of the vena cava intrapericardially, and then you'd have control of the bleeding, at which point you can go ahead and put the clamps on the aorta and put a Rommel tourniquet around the intracardiac IVC. And then you can take your time to resuscitate the patient and get the best exposure. But I, you know, going directly through, if there's a hematoma directly zone one over where you have the dotted the dashed line in the middle photo, I would take that approach, divide the ligament of Treitz and then divide the peritoneum over the aorta, and the, you can get good exposure to what you need to see. If it's high up in the retrohepatic vena cava, then you would have to take your time, mobilize the right lobe of the liver, or divide the round ligament to get exposure to the high retrohepatic IVC and do the repair that way.
Nice.
Go ahead.
Well, if you are thinking about a retrohepatic vena cava injury, even then you will need to get access to the suprarenal region. So I always begin with the Cattell maneuver, and maybe you have a good surprise and realize that the injury is not in the retrohepatic area. So I decided to begin as a Cattell maneuver. And actually the site of the injury in the vena cava was just below the renal vein. And so I thought, okay, it's nicer than a retrohepatic vena cava. And the injury was actually small. I think, as I said, I don't know what kind of ammunition was there. And you can have one roll in the entry. And once the pellets are inside, they can go in separate directions. So we have this small injury in the vena cava with obviously active bleeding and for many hours. So how do you suggest to treat that?
Adenauer, can you mobilize it to see the posterior part of it? Are you sure it's just one wound?
Yeah, I know what you are thinking, but the injury was small, and to see the posterior part, I would need to open a little bit the anterior injury.
Yes.
So I can look inside. And this patient, he was so severely in shock that I decided to perform a suture in the anterior wound and see what happens. And sometimes it works. Many times it works. But I completely agree. You need to make sure there is not a posterior injury before closing this patient. But at this time, my idea was, okay, I found a wound, it is bleeding. There was a lot of other injuries. So I just make a stitch here with a 4-0 proline, and it worked well. This injury stopped bleeding, at least for now. And then I decided to proceed with the exploration, and I made a Cocker maneuver. And then I found another source of bleeding. And I didn't like what I saw, but he had another injury in the superior mesenteric vein, just below the pancreas. Also a small injury, a partial injury, bleeding. So what to do with this injury, my friend Parreira, and others? Okay.
Let's ask the audience. Would anyone like to comment on this? The association of vascular injuries like this, they are highly lethal, unfortunately. Are you sure it's just the vein? Can you guarantee it's not an injury to the superior mesentery artery or aorta?
You know, when I made the Cocker maneuver, things were so injured that the trauma has dissected the vein when I got there. And it was obviously bleeding. I saw the hole. So I still didn't look to the aorta. I still didn't look to the superior mesenteric artery. But I know for the fact that the vein is injured. So I will deal with problem at each time.
Would you have any kind of physiologic data at this point? Patient was shocked, temperature, ABG?
This patient was operated many years ago, and I don't have many of the details I like to have. And I choose this case because of the combination of the injuries that I thought it was worth to discuss. But I don't have any intraoperatory data regarding the physiological status. And
so, but let me ask you directly, would you think this patient is a damage control patient? So would you
don't have any doubt that I need to perform damage controls.
Okay. So it's open for discussion. Anyone would like to discuss?
Dr. Hoffman has his raised
hand. Hoffman, yeah. Thank you very much for that. Dr. Horacio.
Yeah. Wow, this is kind of like the worst nightmare. This is some of the worst nightmares that you can expect as a trauma surgeon, because this is based on what the picture you have there is essentially the beginning of the portal vein. You are behind the pancreas, so it's very difficult to get proximal and distal control. You can get distal control maybe in the mesentery, but you have the backflow from the splenic, over the splenic mesenteric trunk. So to get vascular control there is very difficult. And one trick that I learned many years ago, fortunately I had to use it only once in clinical practice, is to divide the pancreas. You divide the pancreas at the neck, and that will give you exposure to repair this type of injuries. And it sounds very dramatic. And I remember the first time I heard this, I said, oh, I would never do this, until one day I was faced with this situation and I had to do it. And I have to say it was really life-saving. But this is some of the worst injuries that you can find. You can ligate maybe the inferior aspect. If it's lower, you will have a lot of intestinal edema. Maybe the inferior mesenteric vein is able to decompress by collaterals. But usually when that happens, you have other injuries there. And the moment you put the clamp, all the tiny veins around it start bleeding a lot, and you cannot see anything. So everything goes through collaterals, to which they are not bleeding until you put the clamp in the main one, and all the collaterals start to bleed. So this is a tough situation. That's all I can suggest. Thank you.
Just making a small comment, the injury was not behind the pancreas. It was just below the pancreas, near to the pancreas, but below. Because of that, I think it was full in zone 2. I know this anatomic category is for the arterial injury, but making a comparison, I think it would be a zone 2 injury. So, and the hematoma had already dissected many of the things there. So I could see the hole in the inferior mesenteric vein.
Were you able to just suture it? I mean, it's a running suture with a small, like purline fiber, or would you have a very, how much structure would you have just suturing it?
Okay, I think that this is the kind of situation that the simpler is the best to perform. And that was exactly what I did. Two sutures and the narrowing in the vein was very small. I got satisfied with that. I know that in the ideal world, you need to perform a debridement of the vein wall, but it's not possible sometimes in these situations. So we had already two injuries, and I proceeded the inventory of the abdominal cavity in the retroperitoneal, and I found two other injuries. The head of the pancreas was destroyed, and you could see obviously a bile leakage from the bile duct. So what to do now?
In the duodenum, what about the duodenum? Did you have a duodenal injury or just in the head of the pancreas?
At this moment, I didn't realize, but because the duodenum near to the head of the pancreas, the second and the third portions, they were okay, at least apparently. Okay. But I didn't, at this point, I was so impacted with the trauma in the pancreas that I went for the pancreas and to contain the bile leakage. And I didn't have time yet to see the first and the fourth portions of the duodenum. But because of the proximity, I know it could be a possibility.
Let me ask you, the bile was draining from the deep part of the wound in the pancreas. Was it correct?
The head of the pancreas.
There was bile going from the deepest part of it. Okay.
The head okay. of the pancreas was open like a flower, Parreira. And you could see... Okay. The bile duct just leaking inside of the pancreatic head. So
you have perhaps a grade 4 or 5 injury in the head of pancreas. Whoa. For damage control after 2 major vascular injuries. Who would you like to comment this one?
Dr. Utrecht.
Yes, so in this case, depends on the status of the patient, but I think, to do a repair, the definitive repair would extend the operation. You want to limit the operation. If you needed to do damage control, then what I would do initially is to cannulate the bile duct through the injury of the pancreas, thread the cannula proximally, and then leave drains on the outside. In the area of the injury, then get out, wait for the physiological condition to improve, then go back. But it depends on how it would look. So in a child, the bile duct would be small, just a few millimeters. And any repair would be difficult, you know, whether you, if you did in an adult a colidoco, do it an ostomy, that's difficult for a normal sized duck, or any kind of bile anastomosis. But the options would be to bring a Roux-en-Y limb up and try to anastomose to the injury through the opened up head of pancreas, just do direct repair there, or to do it more proximally and then ligate the common bile duct distal to the anastomosis. But that's not something I would do unless the patient is really stable, because the incidence of stricture is going to be high, and you know, it'd be difficult to deal with acutely.
Was it bleeding at an hour, or just bile going?
The bile was the most important problem.
Okay.
But I am so happy to hear.
I think it's very difficult to consider this head of the pancreas solvable. I believe you have to really go for a resection, but not in this time. So I'd go for a hemorrhage control. As you said, it's not okay. I just put again a small tube in the bile duct to try to exteriorize it and prevent more bile contamination in the area. So for a second moment operation, it would be not so inflamed. Dr. Hartman.
So I always pride myself that we do everything, but this is something I wouldn't do. This is for a pediatric surgeon. This is not for, if the patient is more or less stable, you do a damage control, pack the area. I would even put a drain. I would put drains around, but I would not manipulate the area, because I will be worried that whatever I do, I can make the situation more difficult to the pediatric. This, it looks to me, based on the location of these injuries, this patient would, which is extremely rare for trauma, but sometimes you have to, this patient would need a Whipple. And if he needs a Whipple, you need to have, as Dr. Untrek said, the bile duct is millimeters. You need to have a pediatric surgeon used to do this type of anastomosis in kids, in babies with biliary atresia, things like that. This is not something that I would personally do. And if the patient is more or less stable, I would do the damage control, and after that get help, rather than try to fix everything in one shot myself. And I will do minimal manipulation, because I have no idea how this is going to be fixed in a tiny kid. I don't even know if the gallbladder can be used for anastomosis instead of the common bile duct instead. I really don't know. So the less I do, I will give more freedom whoever comes after to fix this.
Completely agree.
As we are discussing damage control options here, so Dr. Hartman just drained the head of the pancreas. Was it correct? Is it correct, Dr. Hartman?
Yeah, we just put some drains around it and get out.
Okay. I
think that damage control is really necessary here. I think if I can stop the contamination from the bile, it's good to perform that, the cannulation. And that was exactly what I did here. So you can see here the exposure provided by the Cattell and the Cocker maneuver. You can see in the picture the superior mesenteric vein, the head of the pancreas, the bile duct already with the catheter, the gallbladder, the inferior vena cava with a little bit narrowing where I did the suture, the kidney, and the ureter. And so that was what I did. And my worst nightmare has become a reality when I continued exploring and found out that the first part of the duodenum was completely separated from the stomach and also from the jejunum. So that combination of injuries was unique for me. And the duodenum was floating in the cavity. It was only attached to what has remained from the pancreas. And I need to deal with that. And the patient was obviously very unstable. So the pylorus was completely transected, and also the trites angle didn't exist anymore. So any thoughts about how to deal with this?
Anyone would like to comment? Please raise your hand.
I think nobody wants to comment.
No, well,
because it was a disaster.
You know, these meetings have this quality of exposing us to situations that we eventually will have to face in the future. And this is very good for us. That's where we learn how to manage. And we are not alone when it happens, because we remember our teachers, you know, these discussions, and doctors, Dr. Utrecht and Dr. Hoffman, in your comments, and perhaps the decision would be more easy in the next situation we'll be facing such an injury. Dr. Utrecht.
Yeah, well, I think that, you know, the patient's trying to tell you something that in this case, it seems like, you know, Dr. Hoffman said, well, you know, divide the neck of the pancreas as you would for when you do a Whipple. That's exactly where you divide the pancreas. Were you to do that in this case, you know, you'd have the Whipple specimen out, totally out, and, you know, and dividing the pancreas at that point, you'd bluntly dissect with your finger posteriorly and then divide it. You know, that would take a minute maybe, and then the whole specimen would be all but removed at that point. So I think that as a problem, that might be what the patient ultimately needs. But for damage control, you don't need to do that now. You can put drains or quickly oversew if the first portion of the duodenum is completely severed circumferentially. Just sew that closed quickly, pass a tube retrograde through the ligament, through the duodeno-jejunal junction, and then ligate around there to control the drainage, and then so close the proximal duodenum, the distal, they're just on the other side of that injury, and then, you know, you have the drains in, and then you come back later. But it might be that that's what this patient will ultimately need when he recovers from shock, and you can decide what to do. But I wouldn't do that. Try to do a Whipple right now at this point, though.
You wouldn't do that, or
I wouldn't do that acutely unless he were totally stable at that point, and then seeing what it looked like, that, you know, the head of the pancreas is totally destroyed, and basically the Whipple's already done. That there isn't much, you know, if
this. But now, for how would you control the spillage here? Would you just put a stapler in this situation? You just put two staplers, or try to keep the some kind of, you know, anastomosis for?
No, if the patient were stable, then you would go ahead and, you know, if you were not in shock, he was urinating, bleeding controlled, everything is not hypothermic, and really, if the head of the pancreas is destroyed, it's without being there. You have to see what it looks like being there, but it seems like there wouldn't be much to dividing the pancreas through the neck, because the injury seems like it's already done that. It would be sort of trivial. And then if the Whipple resection is all but done, and you can just reach in with your hand and remove the specimen, and the patient is stable, then I would consider going back to finish the reconstruction. If not, you take out the specimen if it's really all destroyed anyway, and then you can temporize, you know, close the put a tube in the proximal jejunum to control spillage. You can quickly sew close the on the duodenal side of the pylorus, and you know, control the bile duct as you have, and then come back another day to do the reconstruction, put a nasogastric tube. If the Whipple is all but done anyway, you just have to reach in, pull it out, and ligate a few small vessels, then I think that would be appropriate. If not, then just leave the drains and control the spillage and get out.
Okay, Dr. Steven Epstein made a comment on the chat. Would you like to open your mic, Steven? He mentioned that the patient was almost 8 hours. Oh, not much. He said, well, it's 8 hours from. So we are talking about damage control here. And I'm pretty much thinking the same. I'll try to make some rapid, the simplest, as you said, the simplest suture to control spillage. And coming back for Whipple, I think this is the point. Nobody's would like to do an operation like this in the first stage, but in the second stage, in the second operation, if this patient survives, it's really, I don't see another opportunity. As Dr. Horman said, it is a situation that it's an operation that is best done by people who does it frequently. And I'm really not doubt that I would bring someone who did this, you know, in a, like for cancer, and do this frequently. So we do it in a pediatric session with an experience in a stable patient in the second moment. Dr. Kassim, would you like to comment? I'm sorry, I didn't see you here. You know, I'm trying to accustom it, get used to this new way of monitoring, which is don't see people, but just the names. Dr. Kassim, please comment on this, and then we finish the case. I'm not listening. Can you talk, Dr. Kassim? We are not listening to you. Your mic is closed. So I think, Dr. Adenauer, we can end the case. Can you go to the end of it and then final comments?
Okay, so these were the last injuries. I didn't have staplers. So I saw the pylorus, the first part of the duodenum, and the distal jejunum. And I just put nasogastric tube to the proximal part of the duodenum from the fourth part and sterilize that so I can decompress the duodenum and any additional drainage of the accessory bile duct that could be there. And this is a video trying to organize all that. So here you see the pancreas and the bile duct. Here you can see the stomach that was closed and decompressed with the nasogastric tube. This is the trites. This is the head of the pancreas, the superior mesenteric and the bile duct is there. The superior mesenteric vein and the injured that was sutured is here. I'm just about to finish. And the inferior vena cava here. And on the other side of all that, the only thing I thought was to decompress the duodenum. So I didn't want to make an obstruction in a closed loop. So I drained it like this. I have never seen such an injury before. And this was the only thing I could think in the moment. And I ligated the jejunum here. And this is how it ended. Of course, there are devices properly designed for temporary abdominal closure, but unfortunately I didn't have anyone. So, and of course we could improvise a vacuum, but at that time it was faster to simply do a classic Bogota bag. The patient survived only for 6 hours after that. And my final take home messages are that I think getting the patient as faster as possible to a trauma center is very important. And unfortunately, we don't have that here in the Amazon region. Many times that's not possible. These patients come in the ambulance for many kilometers. I think damage control and peritoneal maneuvers should be always taught for the surgical trainees. And sometimes you don't have all the resources you should have. And if you don't have it, you know how to improvise when facing difficult situations is very, very important for trauma surgeons, in my opinion. And a well-done damage control, and I did the best I could. I have never faced it as such a combination of injuries like this before. But I think trying to perform a damage control well done is much better than trying to perform a definitive management of such complex injuries. And I would like to tell all the friends that are coming to our Brazilian National Meeting on Trauma that for the first time, I think for the first time, we are going to have a vascular course on trauma for the trauma in general surgeons that are going to attend this meeting. So it would be a pleasure to see you there. And I finish here my presentation. Thanks again for this amazing opportunity, Pajira.
Thank you, Adenauer. Again, it was a very, very interesting case, very educative for all of us. I think the way you decided, you solved the duodenal injury is a very intelligent way to do that. I would do this if I could. And well, I hope I don't have such a case, but you know, if I had, probably I would do what you've done. Well, it's open for discussion. Dr. Cassin said he is sorry to connect. Dr. Cassin, very great presentation. Many people here really enjoying the case. Adenauer, I'm not sure Dr. Martus is present. He would like to make some comments. Dr. Martus, please go ahead.
Yes. Thank you very much. Yes. Thank you very much. This meeting is very, very special. And like Dr. Pajera said, we're always learning with each other for 14 years, discussing the management of a patient. We have the same goals, but manage different ways based on our experience and the local research, etc. But it's a very good meeting. I just need to applaud Dr. Adenauer Jr. because he has been always giving us great cases, amazing lectures, and it's always so nice to see a young surgeon, right? A friend from Brazil, just always, he lives in North Brazil, just giving us a lot of good cases where you learn a lot. It's really a pleasure and honor to have this BITE, the Brazilian Trauma Society, in partnership with the Pan-American Trauma Society on these meetings every first Monday of the month. Thank you all, and Dr. Pajera, please, back to you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. For it's by the very, it's a honor and it's a pleasure. And you know, everybody asks me for first thing in the morning and Mondays, they ask me, where is the link? Where is the link? Please, the link. And then we actually every single morning on Monday, first thing in the week, we put in our chat. We have a WhatsApp chat and it's called broadcast for this BITE members, and every single week we have this meeting shared for everybody. So for us it's kind of a common idea. Thank you very much for that. See you.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Next week is with the waste. Thank you. See you later.